he just becomes ineffective. I mean,
That's
right now,
true.
the Quins are on Indeed.com trying to find a running back for him because
You
there's just
just say
nobody there.
NFL's looking on
When they could have just used a third rounder and went and got Joe Mixon or Kareem Hunt
right.
or Devontae Freeman instead of being cheap.
Yeah, but you know what?
Le'Veon
the funny
Bell
thing
was
is,
available.
Yeah, but the no, yeah, but the thing is that Bill Belichick set the market, like Dave said the other day, at a ridiculous part of for any premier players, because Sanu's not a premier player and he got traded for a second round pick. So that basically
right.
puts any premier player at a minimum of starting at a first round pick. And at right now, the way it's going, those first round picks, they're just too valuable because you can get premier players we've seen year after year.
You can get
on
like Mitch
cheap.
Trubisky with a first rounder.
Oh my God.
You also got to trade 4 draft picks plus the first rounder to
right.
go get him.
Only
right.
the Patriots can do that, though. Only the Patriots can trade for Mohamed Sanu a second rounder.
But that's
because
that,
they don't.
Bill did that on purpose,
they don't
though.
Care. They,
yeah, but
they
no,
don't know.
It's not
they
didn't
know.
Care. Think about it, Julius. He did it on purpose. That was my point the other night on last night's episode for First and Goal. He put a stranglehold on the market. He
yeah.
sacrificed his second round pick to trade for Sanu. So now there's a standard for
markup.
All skill position players. Exactly. It's a
He's
complete
a
markup value.
No, I don't think that's what it was, man. I just think that that Bill Belichick, he's the only one that can do that. Who else would use a
well,
second
true.
Round?
Yeah, he's the only guy that can go lay
that's,
his junk on the table and show it to everyone. And
but
that's
I don't think
that's it affected the market. I don't
that's
think
what
anybody else would try that.
Well, but that's what Dave's point is nobody else has the trust. Or the fact that he is both judge, jury, and executioner when it comes to player personnel, the GM. He's everybody.
Yeah, he
he's
has
the
full
coach,
control. Kraft
the GM,
has no
the
say.
Player person. And then Kraft just trusts him. Like, Kraft is like, yeah, whatever, man, here you go. And so, yeah, Bill can lay his horse cock out on the table and say, yeah, who else wants to do it? And everybody else looks around and says, I'm not unzipping my pants, dude. Screw that shit. Like, so
he has two other coordinator rings from the Giants on his junk when he lays it on the table. That's where the other two rings are.
It's really yeah. interesting, you guys, talking about guys' junk and the Kraft and Robert Kraft. I just think, you know.
It was a good massage, JB. How dare you?
God damn it, JB. I almost spit all over my brand new computer. God damn
yeah.
it.
That's what she said. Anyways.
Yeah, man. I think Matt Stafford, though, like
he stepped up this season. He really has.
If he continues playing the way he's playing, we got a shot. So
I agree.
We'll see.
Now, with the reaction of Quandre Diggs getting traded, I brought this up earlier, but I want to get back to it. Is Quinn losing the faith of the locker room, and it's just not publicly showing? Because when he got traded, Slay, Snacks Harrison, Gerard Davis, I saw Kerryon go on and say something, and he's only a second-year player. I mean, that shows how beloved Diggs was in the locker room, and you told me that. So, I mean, do you think that there's a little bit of a crack in the cement with Quinn doing that to that locker room, trading their captain?
It's possible. It's definitely possible. I mean, Diggs was having a bad season, and he was having some injury problems. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, trade him for – but we trade him for nothing. That's the problem.
Yeah.
We didn't get nothing back. We got a fifth.
You gave
rounder.
Up a seventh and him for a fifth. That's yep. the thing. You paid double for it, basically.
Exactly. And I understand getting rid of him while you can. We weren't going to re-sign him after his contract. But, I mean, he was – like he said, he was a captain. Like, I mean, it's already been questions about – Bob Quinn and Matt Patricia losing that locker room. And I don't know. At this point, I just don't know. Like, sometimes after a win, it looks like Patricia has this connection. And then when the wheels start to fall off, you know, it seems like he doesn't, there's not the glue that a lot of the good coaches have with their players to get them through the hard times. So I'm waiting to see that from Patricia, but I don't know. Quinn and Patricia might just think they have a third year locked up already, so they're just going to plan for the future and do what they do.
I don't know. I watched Caldwell take out of the playoffs 2 out of 3 years, and then the third year it was 9-7, and he got let go.
Well,
so the Ford family doesn't play.
It's been said that Rod Wood and Martha Ford has put in their trust in Patricia and Quinn for a guaranteed third year, kind of like San Francisco with Kyle Shanahan and them. This is his third year. His first 2 years were really bad, but they trusted him for a third. So there's some rumors that that's kind of like what it is. So Quinn doesn't really have any pressure. But, I mean, as far as locker room morale and as it goes, I mean, it's definitely possible that the locker room has a disconnection from the front office and the coaching staff, which is not good and would explain the inconsistency.
Now, going back to the field, do you think Ty Johnson can do the job? I understand he's a rookie. I understand he's a late rounder.
Ty Johnson has some talent. He averaged 7.5 yards a carry at Maryland. He's a pretty good player. He ran like a 4.3 40 at his pro day. He's fast. He's decisive on his cuts. But we haven't saw a stone cold performance from this season yet. He is a rookie. But now, you know, he's going to be getting a bulk share of the carries. We'll see. I don't think so. I don't see anything super special in him. I mean, he has some ability to make a play here and there. But I'd be surely surprised if he starts, you know, solidifying his role in our backfield. It'd be great, but I'd be surprised.
So, JB, what do you think? Do you think there's a crack in the cement? The previous question, I wanted to see what you said on that, to see what you say. Do you think Quinn is losing the locker room by trading away a captain and seeing players react like that? Or do you think they're going to come together?
Yeah, the reactions we saw on social media after that trade were just horrible. And this is a team that's already kind of fragile in terms of, you know, their morale.
Fragile.
To get rid of a captain like that is just – it's. I don't know who benefited. I really don't.
Nobody. It hurt our team.
No, it's not like the Lions are 1-7. You know, the Lions –
they're 500.
They're a 500 team. This is a tight division. I always say, you don't win the NFC North, you survive it.
True.
In four games, they could go from last place to first place. That's how tight these teams are.
Well, I mean, all right.
Theoretically, it could happen.
So, JB, I got to say something. The last time we were on the show, man, the way the Vikings were playing at the time, you had a whole different like tone in your voice. You can tell you're more upbeat now. You're happy.
I like this JB better.
I know. Last time he was like, man, I don't know what we're going to do with Kirk.
You get a soft four-game schedule like the Vikings have, and it'll change your demeanor in a hurry, though.
There he is. There's the JB.
I mean, let's be honest. We'll talk about this later, but like, who did we really beat in the last four games? I'm not. Hey, you have to play who you play, and I'm not. I'm happy, but I got issues, and we'll talk about that later. This is the Lions segment, so I don't want to get into it right now. But
I got you. I was just. Your tone was a little different last time. Now it's a little more upbeat, and I just wanted to make sure, man.
Well, we lost to Chase Daniels. I mean, in all honesty, putting Trubisky out of that game was the worst thing the Vikings could have done.
So maybe that was the fire that kickstarted the whole thing. Like, hey guys, we just lost to Chase Daniel. Let's get our shit in gear.
Yeah, and you get fined for injuring Mitch Trubisky because it cost you the game. Because I think if he stays in, the Vikings win the game.
Yeah, true. I actually agree with that. I actually agree with that a lot because y'all beat the crap out of him last year.
Those two games. I think the Vikings would have had a better chance to win that game if Trubisky was still in there. I don't want to take away from the Lions segment here.
Nope. So, Julius, I got to ask. I know you didn't want to be asked this, but I asked Austin the same thing. You know what's coming. What do you see the Lions doing for the rest of the season? We'll obviously get back to this at the three-quarter mark, but what do you see happening? Do you see them sneaking as a wild card? Do you see them going 8-7-1, 7-8-1? Do you see them sneaking in at 9-6-1 and edging a team out because you guys have the tie?
All right, so I don't think the wheels are going to completely fall off. Okay. So I'm thinking worst-case scenario is what we all predicted from the beginning, that they're going to be a 500 average football team, just like they are now. But let's say they put some things together, all right? They need to win the last nine games at least. And like I said, at Minnesota and week 17 against the Packers at home are the two games that I feel the worst about. just off recent performances by those teams and how we played against them, blah, blah, blah. The Bears, as long as they got Mitchell Trubisky under center, I feel like the Lions can take both games. We played great against them historically last few years. I don't trust Mitch. I expect to beat the Bears when we play them. The Cowboys, inconsistent, that we could win. Redskins, supposed to be a win. Buccaneers, supposed to be a win. Denver, supposed to be a win. We had a real gauntlet of a schedule the first half of the season, and we're at 500.
It's gotten softer on the back end. Yeah, it has.
So it gets a little soft, but we got to win the games we're supposed to win, and that's pretty much it. We can't do what the Lions teams of past have done and lose to the Redskins or lose to Tampa Bay. If that happens, the season is over. We're going to finish 500. It's a waste. We're not even going to get a good draft pick. I'm going to be pissed, and I'm going to want everybody to get fired. But right now, in my gut, I feel like we're a borderline playoff team, and like it's going to come down to the end. And I can see us – now, I don't see us winning the division at this point. The Packers have – you know, y'all have a pretty good, like, cushion. And Minnesota's, you know, pretty strong. They're looking like a strong wild card. So I think it's going to come down to week 17 against – Green Bay, y'all going to have the division locked up, and we're going to have to probably need to win to get in. And I don't think they will. I think we're going to miss the
But you're season. At home that game, too. So if they're already locked up and they're not trying to get a bye.
I have hope. Yeah, but, I always have hope. But right now, if I was a betting man, I'm saying the Lions are not making the playoffs this year. And unless I see something different schematically – and you know, unless I see the holes start to fill out, like the run defense and our running game, do one of our running backs step up? Something has to happen for me to change that prediction. So right now, I see the Packers winning division. I see Minnesota's a strong wild card, and I see the Lions on the outside looking in third place. I think the wheels are gonna fall off with Chicago and Mitch, and they're gonna finish last.
So I got something on this. I'm looking at the schedule right now, and I'm counting it up. You're at three wins right now. If you split the Bears the win loss, that puts you at 4-4-1. You take the Cowboys, the Redskins, and the Cowboys are beatable. And it's shown that you can use the flats. If you have a running back, like you guys have a perfect weapon, J.D. McKissic, he is a perfect weapon of that quick flat pass that those linebackers on that defense cannot get to. Aaron Jones exploited the hell out of that in that game. So if you can use that on that front seven, it's going to force that secondary to play a little bit more press man. And guess what? Y'all have Marvin Jones and Kenny Galladay. So y'all can go toe-to-toe with that offense. So I think y'all can beat the Cowboys because I watched a lot of teams beat them that weren't supposed to, and Green Bay swallowed them. So, I mean,
the two Bears games.
I say split it. I say split them.
The two Bears games and the Dallas game are the three most important games we have left. We need to desperately try to win those three games because we can take care of Washington, Tampa, and Denver. We can spare a loss against Minnesota and Green Bay. But those two Chicago games and that Dallas game is going to define our season, in my opinion. So
that's one of the most realistic takes I think I've heard you come up with since I met you. The first time I talked to you, you guys were going 13-3 and beating everybody.
As the season goes on, realism hits.
Julius, I got to say this. I'm looking at it with the way you and I are discussing right now, and also JB has brought this up. The Lions could go into week 17 as 8-6-1. And like I said, I think, and you go against Green Bay, who is probably already going to have a playoff seed by then. If it continues, I'm not guaranteeing anything. I'm just saying the way it's projecting. And if they end up, even as, like, say they lose a couple games down the road and they slide to, like, a wild card and they're guaranteed in the playoffs still, that last wild card spot is open. I mean, then it's the Packers' fate to basically kick them out or let them in. And we've seen what happened when, what was it, the Bears played the Packers in 2010, and the Bears didn't beat the Packers to keep them out, and Packers went on a historic run. So, I mean, it's like you got to keep that team from getting out that can get hot. So I just think, yeah, it comes down to that week 17 game, in my opinion.
I agree. And With no running game, I could see Darren Bevell turn into a step.